church. Happy Mother's Day 2018. Before we begin our time of teaching, there's just a few things that that I need to follow up and update you on. Last Sunday, I came before you and I asked a simple plea, and that was I asked you to pray for Robert Williams. Last Sunday, Robert was in ICU. He had a machine that was breathing for him. At that time, the doctors nor Janine knew whether or not he would come out of that mode, and if he did, whether there would be brain damage or not, because he'd gone without breathing for up to 10 minutes before the paramedics got him. Very bad, dire situation. We all pray for Robert this last week. And I'm happy to tell you that this last week they removed the ventilator from Robert. He is breathing on his own. When Janine was there, when the tube came out of his throat, he looked at her and said, "Have you been here all this time?" And then he said, "You're cute." Needless to say, Robert's mental faculties are there, okay? That is nothing short of a miracle. And we thank the Lord for that. Janine thanks you all for praying for Robert. So can we just thank the Lord collectively for his good things, okay? Keep praying for Robert. I don't mean to in any way, shape, or form insinuate that he is good to go. We need to keep praying for Robert. And he is still in ICU. And Janine has asked that no visitors until he gets strong enough to where he can have visitors. So keep praying. I also want to just put an exclamation point on two things. One, the Decision America effort on June 5th. Be there. It's our opportunity to begin to point not just Anderson and Redding, but California and our nation back to God. That's why Franklin Graham is coming through town, is to try to get our nation steered somehow back to where we recognize God, where he needs to be recognized. Okay? So come and be supportive of that. There are flyers out on the round table in the foyer for you to pick up, as many of those as you want. Take them and give them to your friends, your co-workers, your next-door neighbors, and invite them to come and be a part of going back to God. I also want to encourage anybody that can to come to the graduation banquet this coming Friday. Scott's got tickets. It's always a great event to honor our kids that graduate from high school. We always have phenomenal kids that have made their way through high school and moving on to the bigger and better things. So encourage them at this key point in your life. And I wanted to recognize a special couple that's here this morning. Jacob and Samantha Foster. I know this is embarrassing for you, but would you two just stand up right now? This is one of the most recent married couples in all of Shasta County. Okay? Jacob and Samantha. I had the honor of going to their wedding last Saturday and seeing them commit to one another and become Mr. and Mrs. Foster. And we're happy for you guys. We are happy that you guys are with us and that you guys are a married couple. Love you guys. And Becca, stand up next to them, because Becca Brown has moved back to Redding, and she's back in our area. So good to have Becca, okay? Good to have you guys. You guys can be seated. And then I don't want to start teaching without wishing Deb happy birthday today. Okay, happy birthday to you. And Natalie, I've already said it, I'll say it publicly, happy birthday to you. Natalie is not only celebrating her birthday today, but Mother's Day. That is the quintessential double dipper if I've ever heard, okay? But happy birthday and happy Mother's Day to all of you. There's a four-year-old boy, and he went shopping with his mother to a big shopping center. And when he got to that shopping center, he got detached from his mom. And 4 years old and a big store, you'd get nervous real quick. And so he started crying right where he was at in the middle of the aisle. And all on his own, he started crying and he started yelling, "Jessica! Jessica! Jessica!" And his mother, three aisles, overheard the cry. She came running around and she says, "Honey, I'm here. Don't be scared. Your mom's right here." But why Mothers are special. Mothers are special. And today is a day that we call you by name. We know you have another name, but we call you Mom today to honor you and to bring honor to you, just like Scripture calls us to honor mothers and fathers. So I want to put something up here on the board. Here's a quote. All that I am or hope to be, I owe to my angel mother. All that I am or hope to be, I owe to my angel mother. Who made that quote? That quote was made by none other than arguably the greatest president the United States has ever seen, Abraham Lincoln. He said that amidst being a president. He said that at a time in which he could reflect back on his life and not see himself as a president, but see himself as a byproduct of what his mother helped make him to be. So this morning we honor our moms, our grandmas, our great-grandmas. Do we have any great-great-grandmas in the audience? Raise your hand if we do. Okay, there's one. Anybody, any other great, there's one. Okay. We have three. Let's give them a special round of applause, okay? Great, great grandma. I mean, you guys are all great, but there's some great greats, okay? Mothers are like precious gemstones. Multiple facets, yet intricately connected. Yes, they're compassionate. Yes, they're gentle. Yes, they are sensitive. Yes, they are some of the best multitaskers the world has ever seen. Someone told me that mothers are proof that evolution doesn't always work because mothers still, to this day, only have two arms and two hands. Okay? Yes, they are kind. Yes, they are godly. And yes, they are devoted. But this morning, for just a few minutes, I want to talk about the toughness of mothers. The toughness of mothers. I've entitled this lesson, One Tough Lady. Because looking back on my mom, she was all that. She is godly. She is kind. She is sensitive. She is devoted. But she is one tough lady. How many of you have or had the blessing of having a mother who was one tough lady? Show of hands. Look at you. We honor that this morning, this toughness, okay? Because there's a lot of you who, like me, experienced and lived to appreciate the fact that your mother was one tough lady. And I want to just talk about a couple of attributes of being a tough mother. A godly mother consistently disciplines those she loves. A godly mother consistently disciplines those she loves, just like God does. In Hebrews, the 6th chapter, verses 5 through 6, the scriptures say this: "My son, do not make light of the Lord's discipline." There's a lot of people in this world that would like to make light of discipline. They would like to say discipline doesn't have a place or get rid of it. Okay? Hebrews 6, 5 through 6 says, "My son, do not make light of the Lord's discipline. And do not lose heart when he rebukes you. Because the Lord disciplines the one he loves. And he chastens everyone he accepts as his son." Hebrews 6 will go on to say that if you're not disciplined by God, you're not a legitimate son of his. That's how we can tell we're connected to God. It's by as sons, is the fact that he disciplines those of us, the ones he loves. You see, mothers form hearts and minds. And one of the most important ways in which they form hearts and minds of their children is to effectively shape their hearts and minds. my mom just didn't have timeouts. She took timeouts to speak to my room.
Dennis, Laura, Philip, and Doug.
5 of us went to the Imperial Downey Church of Christ, which was just a walk around the corner, the church building. And we cleaned the church building every Saturday morning. We weren't paid for doing that. We weren't janitors. We weren't on staff or anything. Mom volunteered us. I didn't raise my hand. Mom volunteered us to go clean up. And so I was responsible for making sure the cards were in the back of the pews. There were pencils in the back of the pews. That the floor was vacuumed. I talked my sister into doing the toilets. Okay, she was gracious enough to do that. We cleaned that whole church building from top to bottom every Saturday morning. That is stuck in my mind. That is stuck in my mind. My mom is 86 years old today. And 2 years ago, I said I would make her 84. I called her up on the phone. Hey, Mom, how you doing? What are you doing? Mom said, oh, I'm just busy. And I said, Mom, what are you busy doing? And she says, I'm busy helping prepare for a funeral. Oh, really? Who died? And she told me the name of the person from the church that she's associated with in Fresno that passed away. And she says, and this church member has a lot of friends and a lot of family and people are coming into town. I said, how many people are going to be there at the funeral? And she says, about 300. I said, Mom, what are you doing? She said, I'm preparing the food. I said, how many people you got helping you? She said, just me. I said, Mom, you get on the phone and get some other ladies, get some other men to help you out. She said, I'll get it done. That's my mom. I called her up just a few weeks ago. And she's got a tumor behind one of her eyes. And I said, Mom, what are you doing? She says, I just got done crocheting 400 hats that she's going to give to the fire department so that when the fire department responds to people that have lost their clothes and stuff, they can put a hat on little kids' heads. And she says, I'm getting ready to start on my next project. I said, what's that, Mom? She says, I'm crocheting a blanket for every one of the widows and widowers of the church. 34 of them. 34 blankets. I share that with you, I guess, in some way to brag about my mom. She listens to me. But more than bragging on my mom, I want to tell you that life has shaped me. Made me who I am today. And your service, moms, grandmas, great-grandmas, and great-great-grandmas, your service to the Lord is shaping the lives of your kids today. You may not even know how it's shaping. You may not even know that they know that you're teaching a Bible class on Sunday morning, or preparing breakfast, or taking food to somebody in their home, or doing service at the ACCA, or Laundry Love. But I'm telling you, it makes a difference by serving. This must be exactly what Paul was referring to in Romans 16. I'm not going to read Romans 16. But I want you to go home and read Romans 16 by yourself. And that chapter starts off to the very first person that Paul recognizes in Romans 16 is a woman. Her name's Phoebe, and she was a deaconess. That means servant. And Paul says, show her honor, because she's deserving. And he goes on to the whole rest of the chapter. There's men and there's women that he just exalts and lifts up and says, thank you for being who you are. Thank you for being servants. Thank you for being the kind of people that have shaped lives all your life. quote that you can relate to, that resonates with you about your mother, I'm just going to encourage you to stand. Okay? So here goes. This is a quote from Thomas Edison, arguably one of the greatest inventors of all time. And he summed up his mother this way. I quote. And you stand. I did not have my mother long enough, but she cast over me an influence which has lasted all my life. The good effects of her early training I can never lose. If it had not been for her appreciation and her faith in me at a critical time in my experience, I should never likely have become I was always a careless boy, and with a mother of different mental caliber, I should have turned out badly. But her firmness, her sweetness, her goodness were potent powers to keep me in the right path. My mother was the making of me. The memory of her will always. Not standing, I'd like to invite you to all stand right now. And if you would, grab someone's hand, and I want to fill in the gaps here. So just push yourself this way, reach across the aisles, and grab a hand. Aaron, we're going to sing a song in just a minute. I'm going to lead a prayer right now, and so the song will close us out, okay? Just make it easy. Bow with me in prayer, and if you're standing next to a mother and it's easy for you, put an arm on her shoulder.